Christmas time, and it's a time to focus on the big picture. It really is a time to understand that there's a lot of brokenness in the world, and a lot of loss, a lot of poverty, a lot of illness, a lot of need. And it's always delightful to run into people who are trying to change the world. And my guest today is a case in point. His name is Ted Grant, and he's got a really great story to tell. First of all, I got to tell you, and welcome, Ted.
Thank you.
You're a fellow biker, and any fellow biker is already a friend. You're from PEI, beautiful Prince Edward Island.
Thank you.
Kathy and I were there just a couple years ago on our motorcycles and just loved it, even though it was a little bit foggy and a little bit rainy.
Yeah.
But of course, we made the pilgrimage to Anne of Green Gables farm, and you know, anyway.
Yeah.
You have a great story, and one of the reasons it's so good, in my view, is because it sort of happened. You sort of fell into it, and it was something that was outside of your experience, your range of activity previous to this, and it was 2003. But tell us the story, how you got involved in Kenya.
My wife, Rita, and I had been involved in our church and in the community and all kinds of events and that kind of thing. We've always been quite involved. And we found ourselves in a short period of time there after being involved in Teen Encounter that we were just seemed to be not involved for a period. And so we kept praying and asking, you know, Lord, what is it? How would you want us to be involved in things? And anyway, PEI is a small place, as everyone knows. And there was a picture in the paper of a lady from the village where we do our work, Mikinduri. McKenna Ambassa is her name. Mm-hmm. We didn't know her, but we were reading this paper on a Sunday afternoon, and she was collecting clothing for her village in Kenya. So Rita and I agreed that we should see if we couldn't help her, not knowing her and whatever. But so we called her up and said, McKenna, what kind of clothing do you need? And she said, we gave us the description. So we stuck notes on our neighbor's door and said, we're collecting clothing for Africa, and please put them in garbage container bags, and we'll pick them up on your doorstep in a few days. So we got a van load of clothing and went to meet with McKenna to drop the clothing off, and became involved in a conversation about, why do you need clothing? And, you know, tell us about your village, and how did you get to Canada, and what's going on? And so after an hour and a half of hearing about children being hungry and widows and AIDS and just struggles of life and that kind of thing, we decided, as we're driving home, we looked at each other and we said, gee whiz, we have to be able to do a little bit more than drop off a few bags of clothing. So we approached our pastor, Father John, and asked him if he'd be willing to allow McKenna to come out to speak at the masses on Sundays, and he did. And so people responded. And then we decided, well, this seems to be of the Lord, so let's see what else might happen. So we put an ad in the local paper for a general meeting, and 60 people showed up at the meeting, 50, 60 people. And a couple of these people were from another NGO on PEI, and so that's how it started. And we just, then I was invited to go to Kenya, and I spent a week in Mikinduri back in January of 2004, and that's when I really became convicted that this is what's supposed to be.
You been to Kenya or Africa before?
No.
What were your first impressions when you went to the village? Mikinduri, it's called?
Mikinduri. M-I-K, yeah.
What were your impressions?
I was struck by the beauty of the people, the generosity and the beauty and the need and the struggle and the courage, especially of the women.
Yeah.
The courage of the women, how they can get up in the morning and have nothing for their children, and giving them filthy, dirty water, and then take a bucket and walk 3 or 4 miles to the brook and get more dirty water and walk back with sore backs and sore legs and sore necks. And the courage is amazing to me, the courage of the people, especially the women and the children.
You know, you see women carrying a bucket of water on their head, and their backs are so straight, their posture is perfect. It looks beautiful, looks kind of elegant, but that's a lot of weight.
I've tried it.
Yeah, and your neck, the smaller your back. And in the work that we do in Africa, one of the key things we do is bore holes so women don't have to walk to water, and also the water they get is good water.
Yeah.
You know, the average woman in Africa spends about 2.5 to 3.5 hours a day just going to and from a water source.
Yeah, exactly.
So What was project one? What did you start doing?
Well,
there?
The first thing we did was we hired a consultant to do a study to find out what's the on the ground there, and then we met with the leaders in the community and said, what is it? We have no experience, no experience whatsoever. So you have to help us to see if we are able to get resources to help you. What is it that you need from us? And so we met with the local leaders, the church leaders, and the teachers and headmasters and so on. And we discovered that, and the analogy I use, it was like a bucket full of all kinds of holes. So the first thing we needed to do was, before we could start building up, we had to start filling some holes. And so we started, the very first thing we did was we introduced a feeding program for the orphans. And so we worked with a local pastor there, Pastor Karugu, and we sent money over. And we continued to do fundraising and PEI. And we at the time, we kept trying to find an existing NGO that had an interest in working with us in that area that did believed in the same kinds of things we believed. We didn't have much success with that. So it just inked its way along. So the first thing was feeding programs, and then we said, okay, water. We have to do something about water. Yeah. So we started digging some wells and ran some pipelines. And then when we got a few of the holes plugged in the bucket, the idea then was, okay, what can we do to help them to raise themselves up? How can we support them in what ways? And so we started a sewing center to provide training for young boys and teenagers to develop a trade. And we currently now have an agricultural program where we have 200 farmers registered in a program called E-Roots. And the idea there is to introduce new kinds of crops and micro-irrigation and that kind of thing.
Now, isn't this interesting, Ted, as you're telling me about the growth and the development of this ministry? It began with you collecting clothing from your neighbors.
Yeah.
And this is so often the way it is, you know, in countless encounters I've had in Africa with ministries that are really making a difference, they start with one person basically ministering to one person or being impacted by one person and doing something small. And it seems to be the Lord's way. It just kind of grows something incrementally. Mm. I've often said the only thing that grows fast in the world of nature is weeds. You know, the real good stuff just kind of takes its time. You know, a good oak tree takes a long time to grow, ring by ring by ring. But boy, try to take it out of the ground. Yeah. It's there for the long term. Same thing with your ministry. Now, you formed your own NGO, right?
Yes.
What's it called?
Mikinduri Children of Hope Foundation.
And by the way, where is Mikinduri in Kenya?
Well, if you're familiar with Kenya, as you probably are.
Yeah, I am. Yeah.
If you know where Mount Kenya is.
Right.
It's about 50 miles due east of Mount Kenya. It's quite remote. For years, it had no presence in government. It was represented by a member of parliament who was not from the area. So all of the infrastructure fell apart. There were no NGOs there before we went in.
Now, I think we've brought a little bit of footage of your work, and you can walk us through it. I think it's almost a minute worth. What are we looking at here?
Well, when violence broke out in 2008, we, as an organization, decided that if we were going to be there in the good times, we should be there in the not-so-good times. Mm-hmm. And so we went to a refugee camp in Koguru, in Nakuru, actually, and we spent a month there working with, we did vision, dental, and medical clinics in the camp. And so these are pictures of the locals, that the people were driven from their homes, and they're in the camp there, and the refugee camp, which is, it's quite an experience to spend time in a refugee camp.
Oh.
You know, this was another place where we heard of another camp outside of Nakuru, where we went and we bought some supplies and took them to the people. We brought face hands and dish face cloths and mattresses. One of the things we did was we bought mattresses for the elderly and the mothers who had babies and the disabled. So this was, we spent a month there in that camp, and that was it was just a mind opening bending experience.
It
really was amazing.
You know, I've been astonished as I've gone into African homes, and generally in the rural areas where we work, there's always at least one person in the home who is dying of AIDS, and in many cases they're just lying right on the ground.
Yeah.
They might have a blanket, but no mattress, and something as rudimentary as that. I mean, we just take these things for granted here. Yeah. And,